Hey, horse people.
Boys over there eating. Just gave the boys and donkey a little snack. The cow already came over and ate and then left. I think the donkey's just cleaning up. Look at Muddy Buddy. I just did a video this morning of a Mr. T. They both went out and rolled in the pond because it rained yesterday. You can't really see it, old buddy, but Mr. T looks like a damn muddy mess. He's pretty funny.
So, I wanted to, I don't know if this wind, let me move this back just a little bit. Let's talk about horsey stuff. I got a call from a buddy of mine. Used to work together as a cop. And he got a difficult horse, so he gave me a call. Hell, I can't see that damn camera. That damn lens is right in the way. Am I on the camera? Wow. Let me move that down just a little bit. Sorry. Be like, well, just say what you're gonna. Shut up! Somebody put a comment. He starts talking at 3.4 seconds. Shut up, you big dummies. All right. So, I just had a conversation with my buddy who, he's a cop. So, we kind of think alike and we kind of, we have similar experiences. So, it's easier to talk and kind of convey things. But some of his questions he was asking was kind of interesting. And of course, I told him I had a website, and you know, but you know, a lot of guys just aren't reading instructions type. Women like things. I know I'm gonna get sexist comments. Whatever, it's freaking factual stuff. You know, facts. Just because you don't like it, don't change the facts. So women sometimes like more hands reading books. They like, you know, I think that's why Pirelli is so successful. What happened? One of you guys hit the bucket. Did you have to correct Buddy because he's being a bad boy? So, women can kind of get their fingers into something and read it and get the instructions, and they like A, B, C, D. Very, very, I don't want to say simplistic, but they women are more likely, let me say it this way, women are much more likely to read instructions and ask for directions than guys are. How about that? And to appease all the little feminazis and sensitive women out there with the rice paper feelings, he just hates women! Let's say it this way. Men are too stubborn to ask for directions or read instructions. There, you happy? Now I'm cracking on men. Stupid men. Can't even read directions. Whatever. Alright, horsey stuff. So he's asking me, he got this horse, and it's just amazing on like technology. I mean, I would love to work with this horse that he's got. And he's in another state. I don't want to say a state. Somebody be stalking him and tracking him down. I heard you were friends with Rick. Shut up. So, he gets this horse from this guy who's shutting down his mountain trekking business. And he's got, this guy, I guess, had 40, 50 horses. And he was getting rid of his horses. And I guess my buddy, I don't know if I should say his name, I'll just call him my buddy. So my buddy was working with him and riding horses in a while, working cattle with him. So this guy's shutting down his business, getting rid of his horses, and he told my buddy that he would like give him his pick and give him some good horses. Well, of course, my buddy, being a guy, type A cop, macho, whatever you want to call it, just a guy's guy, he picks the biggest, baddest horse that the guy told him, yo, man, you got to be careful with this horse. When he was telling me this story, I was like, dude, you're killing me. I said, he's got 50 horses, and he tells you, man, you got to be careful with this horse. He's a man's horse. Oh, my God, here comes the women. That's sexist. I just shut up. It's a term in common usage that everybody knows what it means. And it doesn't mean good thing. If somebody tells me it's a man's horse, that tells me that stupid men have had it who have manhandled it, and they don't know anything about horsemanship. Otherwise, if it was just a horse, which it is, anybody that understands horses could work it. So when somebody tells me this is a man's horse or this is a woman's horse, I automatically know they don't know what the hell they're talking about. In my opinion. Somebody, he thinks he knows. Shut up, you big dummies. I'm damn tired of reading crazy ass comments from you weirdos. So, When as soon as he tells me this story, he's like, yo, man, this guy pulled me over and goes, look, this horse is all go. He's a man's horse. When you get on him, you better have a handful of reins. And I mean, he's just, when he's telling me, and I go, so let me get this straight. That's the horse you wanted. He goes, yeah, I got him. So anyway, so now he's like, dude, man, this horse is kind of, you know, he's very strong and kind of, he didn't say he was scared because I know what fear is. I mean, cops get scared when we go into a building to clear it and there's a guy in there with a gun or we don't know if he has a gun and then we find him in a closet and our sphincter shrinks up and we're like, get your damn hands up! We start screaming. I know what that kind of fear is, but for somebody to go, well, you know, sometimes I get scared when I clear a house. That's not what we mean when we get scared. So when he said, because man, this horse makes me a little nervous. He goes, I'm not really scared of him, but I go, I get it, brother. So he says the horse's problem is, that's a clue. When he squeezes him or clicks into from a trot to a canter, man, he just goes from 0 to 60, wants to run, he rears up and he throws his legs in the air and he takes off, man. He goes, I really gotta hang on the horn and control him because he gets me off balance and now I'm kind of stopping him. I'm like, okay, sounds like a smart horse. So we had this long discussion and of course, there's no way that I can explain, and I told him, I go, dude, me explaining horsemanship to you is like putting a guy, you know, a six-month academy, then he goes through 6 months of an FTO with somebody training him one-on-one, and then he goes out on his own, he's on watched for another year, and then he finally becomes just a regular street officer. I go, me trying to explain a horse is like putting a guy in an eight-hour class in an academy and going, okay, go out and hit the streets and expecting him to succeed. I said, he's going to fail. So, you know, when we're talking, we had, I don't know, maybe an hour and a half conversation, and he would ask questions, and I would give this long dissertation about how that question is really not answerable. And every time he asked me a question, well, what do I do with this? I go, it depends. And that's kind of a thing that I use in law enforcement and police work, because when you get into court and legal systems, some, you know, you ask a lawyer a question, if he gives you a straight-out answer, this is what's going to happen, I don't believe him. Because it all depends. It depends on the judge, it depends on the other attorney, it depends on the parties involved, it depends who knows who, etc. There's all these factors on how things happen in the legal system. And horses, same way. It depends. Because I don't know the background of the horse, I don't know the experience of you, I don't know when you do something wrong or right, if you think it's right, I don't know if you're letting other people have, I don't know what prior training the horse had, I don't know injuries, things about, I don't know all these factors, and you call me and expect an answer to fix the problem with the horse. Now, he wasn't doing that. I mean, we're old buds. I mean, we used to go snow skiing and do all kind of shit together. I think I've told a couple crazy cop stories that involved him. I don't know if I told the one, well, I don't want to say that one now because I'll dog him out. But anyway, I digress. I'm not on my cop channel. I can't even tell the cop stories. Let's stick to horses. So, a couple questions I ask him, like I would ask anybody, is, you know, how does a horse ride normally? Does the horse flex? And he's like, yeah, I bend him. And I go, well, what do you mean when I bend him? And he goes, well, you know, everybody tells me I should do it more, but he goes, I don't really. He goes, should I like do it like 50 times each time I do it? I go, absolutely. And to me, that was such an outrageous question, but I guarantee you somebody told him that. Look, if you're doing something 50 times in a row to a horse, it ain't learning anymore. It's punishment. The horse is not learning where to get the release. He's not learning the right answer. You're not teaching him what he needs to do correctly to get the right answer. You're punishing and torturing him. If you've got a horse that you're flexing for 50 times, you are not teaching that horse to flex. You are antagonizing, irritating, frustrating, roboticizing your horse. I mean, you can call it what you want. You're not teaching that horse. If I can get a horse, I can get on Buddy or Mr. T, and if they don't flex real nicely, and if they ain't flexing two or three times of me doing it, I'm not going to keep doing it. Something else is going on. Neck pain. The horse doesn't feel good. I haven't worked him up. Maybe I need to get on the ground. Maybe I need to do some lunging. Maybe I need to get him changed directions. Maybe I need to get, you know, And the things that I told him are things that you people have heard, but because he's never heard it or done it, they were kind of like Greek to him. So, you know, I'd always say, look, man, a slow way is a fast way. Take your time. It's a process, not an event. Don't get out there and try to fix this. You know, he goes, man, I've been riding him three times, and I'm like, three times? Are you kidding me? You're not going to fix a problem in three times. First of all, it's kind of like the lady that kicked the horse to fix the bucking problem when she couldn't even saddle the horse or control the horse. She couldn't tie the horse with any length of lead rope. She had the horse tied up short. She was fighting it to get the saddle on, and she was kicking it before she ever got on it, and she was focused and saw, I'm fixing a bucking problem. She wasn't fixing the bucking problem. The horse had all these other holes in training. There was no communication, long-term, you know, relationship. And I told him that. I go, dude, man, a horse is like a relationship. If you've got, you know, it's a relationship with your kid or your wife or somebody, you can't just treat it like, yo, man, I got 5 minutes to teach you this. Let me teach you this, then we'll move on. I said, it's an ongoing process. This horse has to learn how to read you, and you have to learn how to read it. So, and of course, if he's getting a horse from a ranch, you know, he said all these guys rode with big bits, manhandled. They were just get on, hang on, kick, go. But he goes, the horses did this every day. They trucked stuff up and down the mountain. He goes, they would work these horses for 3 days straight loading shit, and then they'd cut them loose, put a bell around their neck, and just let them loose in the mountains with the bears and animals. And then they let them go graze for a day, and then they had alfalfa chips or cubes that they'd shake, and the horses would hear it, and they would come running. When they'd catch it, they'd hook it up for the alfalfa and go saddle it up and go to work. He goes, and that's how his horse lived. He goes, this horse has a split ear, a big gash out of the neck. It was fighting off bears. He goes, these horses aren't scared of anything. He goes, he's not scared of a bear or nothing out in the wild. He's just great confidence. He goes, but I take him in an arena and he starts sweating and he's got diarrhea. And I go, it's all new to him, man. He doesn't know. I mean, he's uncomfortable. And I said, you're trying to fix something, a problem that you see as a problem of him going from a trot to a canter when he can't flex, when you've got him in a new area that he's nervous that he's not been in and there's other horses around him and you've only ridden him 3 days. Just ain't going to work. So, I mean, and he gets that the more I talk to him, but, you know, people that aren't around horses all the time, they just don't get it. And in his case, he was kind of what I call conditioned or trained by these packers. And packer horses, look, I mean, he flat out said it. He goes, man, you got to understand, these horses, if they're riding up and it don't work or it got hurt, they just put a bullet in it and let the bears eat it so it wouldn't bother their other horses, and they'd move on next horse. He had 45 horses, you know, and they just go through horses left and right. They don't care. I mean, this is going on today. So, I mean, horses that come from this environment, you have to realize, when somebody asks you, how do I fix this horse? Well, if his whole life, the horse is 10 or 11 years old, which means he's at his prime, which means he's probably been rode hard and put away wet for the first 7 to 8, 10 years of his life. You know, I don't know when they started or if you got him at 3 or 2 or 1, you know, ain't no damn telling. But this horse has had a rough life, and he probably only knows big, strong man hands to manhandle him and to pull on big bits and to hurt him and make him and show him who's boss. And that's what he knows. So when Matt's trying to use a softer communication process to him, the horse is totally confused. And he's like, why is this guy weak? Why should I listen to him? He's not making me listen. He's not hurting me. I don't understand it. And now, some of you are going to jump to the conclusion, well, that's why you got to show him who's boss. And if he hurt him, he would listen and make it easier. That's not true. The horse has to be reprogrammed. It's like a kid that you take out of a jungle that's been surviving by himself and killing and eating things. And then you put him in a civilized environment, you bring him to a restaurant and expect him to use silverware. And then call him stupid because he doesn't use silverware. You have to look at the horse where it came from and where you're trying to get it, and then map out that path so you two can learn together and mesh and grow, and he will learn to follow a soft hand and soft direction and good horsemanship, not manhandling horsemanship. And then the horse will grow. And I told him, I was like, dude, calm seas don't make a good sailor. Anybody can sit in a damn sailboat when the sails are full and you're going a straight line. That's easy. I said, you got to go through some storms to learn how to sell a boat. And good horses don't make good horsemen. People send their horses to a trainer and they think they're good horsemen. They got it all figured out and they've never taken a horse from where it was to a better spot and improved it and made the horse grow. They just stand on the shoulders of the trainer that trained it and say, look what my horse can do. Look at me. I understand horses. I'm a horse owner. I know what I'm doing. When they don't know shit. You shouldn't say people. Shut up, you big dummies. I'm trying to tell you the hard truth and not give you comforting lies to make you feel sweet and huggy and want to go grab your pink pillow. So this conversation that I had with him, I was just like, I mean, I was shaking my head on the phone like, man, this is amazing. Because I know this guy, and he was my pee. I mean, we snow skied, we took down bad guys, we worked the streets together. I know him, and it's just like, man, the questions he was asking and the lack of foresight just to see kind of things in a horse's view was just, now, this guy, when we were working together and I had horses, he was like, yeah, I had a horse as a kid. He goes, that horse kicked me, and I hit him in the head with a 2x4, and he never kicked me again. So that was his experience from a youngster having horses. Well, now he's up to my age, and you don't want to do that shit. So, and I told him, I said, look, older people tend to learn better ways to work with horses because they can't just manhandle like they did when they were young and just tough through it. So what? I get bucked off. So what? I can... And, you know, I've been there, done that. I've been thrown by so many horses and so many times, it's not even funny. I mean, people look at me and go, man, you're a great horseman, or you're really good, and you can't... I've been thrown so many times. I mean, I was a very, very proficient racquetball player. I played racquetball almost semi-pro. I'm pretty good at freaking racquetball. And people would get in there who were learning, and they'd be like, damn, how do you hit the ball, and how do you move, and how do you get around? And it's like, dude, I've been doing this for 12 years. I've lost a lot more games than I've won. I mean, you have to put your time in. When I'm snow skiing, we would go, I'd tell stories about going down these crazy mountains where we shouldn't be, going underneath the lines when they close them, and getting trapped and trying to kill ourselves. We snow skied all the time. When we started, we fell a lot. We tripped. We'd be going in a straight line and a freaking snowball this big would cause us to lose the ski and we'd fall. And you know, now we're jumping off rocks and doing twists and flips and all this shit in the air, and it's like, hey, you gotta start somewhere. Nobody becomes good and proficient by reading a book. It is a process. And the problem that I have with a lot of horse people is they watch a couple videos, they read a couple books, and then they have success, minor success, with one horse because they don't ask it to do much, and they put on their little helmet and they get in the arena and they ask it to run in a circle, and then they can lunge it and they can chase it in a round pen, and suddenly they are the horse whisperer of the world. Look at me. I am woman. I have trained a horse because I watched a video and read a book, and look at my horse run around a circle. So those people have no idea about getting out on trails at night, or getting lost, or roping a horse, or roping a cattle and pulling and getting pulled off, or going through water that you don't know how deep it is, and all of a sudden you're walking across a stream and your horse feet fall out from underneath it, and now you're swimming on a horse to find... I mean, they haven't ever challenged their horse. I tell one of the crazy stories on the women that went out by the train. And these group of women, and a woman sent this to me, and she was just laughing her ass off. She goes, Rick, everything you say is so right, man. This is a perfect example. And all these women are going out, and they're running. And all of a sudden, they hear the railroad tracks on a train way away. They hear the horn honking, and they all look at each other and go, train! And they all start running from the railroad tracks because they know if they're by the railroad tracks when a train comes by, they're going to get thrown or knocked off. Their horse is going to freak. So we got to get out of here. So their theory was, when I hear a train, I run like hell so I don't have to deal with it or fix the problem. I mean, it was just so, I'm just like, how worse can you make the horse? And if you don't think that horse heard that train, and pretty soon it learns when it hears a train, suddenly you start hauling ass with your horse is learning already. Now, I've got a couple videos where I'm actually sitting, I think on Mr. T, right by a train as it comes by, and he gets a little antsy and the ground's shaking, and it's nervous. And I think it was like the first, maybe the second time I was by a train with him. But you know what? I'm confident in my skills and in my horse that we can handle whatever comes up. I'm not going to run from something because I don't know what's going to happen. I'm not going to run or live in fear that, oh my God, I hope I never stumble through the woods and find a railroad track with a train or I'm screwed. I'm not going to run through life like that. So understanding these horses and where they come from and where they're going and how the path and everything that links together, it's just such a complex, long-term life learning skill that people want to learn it through a video or buy this video on trailer load and you can trailer load your horse perfect. Buy this video on bucking and you can trade your horse not to buck. Buy this video on lunging and you'll be the greatest lunger in the world. So you got all these people with these library of videos and they don't have a damn clue about horse vision, horse instincts, how they're born, how horses communicate with each other, how they live in a wild, how their survival skill and pain, how it triggers the endorphin boost for their flight response. I mean, they have no clue about any of this, but if you give them their horse, they'll go out there in a round pen and lunge it, and they'll make it look good. So, I mean, just as I'm talking to my buddy, I'm just like, dude, I mean, I was just, the things I was saying. So the one thing that he kind of, after all this talking, he gave back to me, because that's kind of what cops do when we, when we're getting a statement or we're putting a case together or we're doing an investigation, to make sure that your message, there's four things to a message. There's a sender, there's the message, there's the receiver, and then there's feedback. And that's critical that most people miss in communication. See, when I do this video, I'm the sender, there's the message, you're the receiver, and the only feedback I get is when I read comments. So I don't get immediate feedback like facial expressions. When I'm teaching a class, when I was teaching whatever class I was teaching in the academy or at a college or whatever, when I'm teaching, I can read the classroom and I can see students. And when I get that kind of confused deer in the headlights look when I say something, I can tell if I'm losing the audience on a topic, and then I can cover that topic and clear it up. Or I can ask them, you look like you got a question. Then they can ask a question and I can clear that up. When I'm doing videos, I don't have that immediate feedback from you guys. So people go, hey, you talk a lot, you go off on tangents. Because I'm always trying to cover the confused areas that might be confusing to someone newer or hasn't heard the term, and it takes longer to get it out. If I had an outline and I just did it, and I was teaching a class, then I could get immediate feedback and I could correct and modify my subject matter as I'm doing it. But I can't do that on here. So at the end of this video, he's like, okay, so let me tell you what I got out of this. So he gave me some feedback. He goes, it sounds like I need to teach him to bend. I said, correct, flex. And I'm not real big into terms. He says bend, I say flex. Flex is the more recognized term. I'm not trying to, you know, these people that run around the internet and want to tell everybody, you don't call a gray horse white. That's wrong. And that's not a sock. That's a stocking. Or that's not a star. It's a snip. And it's a bar. You know, they're all into terms. And they're all into showing their knowledge on how smart they are about a term. And they just can't wait to correct somebody. You know, if I call a colt, you know, and it turns out to be a filly, I got all these people, it's a filly, you don't even know. I mean, they're all into terms, and I don't like really concentrating on that. I don't really care what you call stuff. I want you to have the concept and the knowledge to help the horse have it easier and have a better life and have better communication, and you both will be safer and better because of it. And there's a less likelihood the horse is going to get a raw deal and get blamed for being bad, malicious, crazy, needs to be put down, oxygen deprived, had a bad trainer, bad breeding, bad color, bad... I don't want that. And if you have the knowledge, I don't really care if you use the right terminology. So sometimes I don't get caught up in that. Yeah, if I want to go read and study and I can find out all the snip, star, stripe, all the markings on the face and all the markings on the legs and all the different colors and the right terminologies and the colt filly and the foal and the mare and the mare in heat and a virgin mare and a maiden mare, and you know, I can get all into names and make it all minutiae, but that's what it is. I don't care about names. I want concept and critical thinking on my message. That's what I'm trying to teach. So when he read back to me, he said, okay, so what I'm kind of getting is I really need to work on bending so he understands it. And what was the other thing he said? Hell, I can't remember. Anyway, so, and then I had to go back and reinforce the bending, because what I told him about flexing, I said, look, you should be able, this horse should flex. And when we started out with the 50 flex, should I do it 50 times? I go, hell no. Don't do it 50 times. You'll end up harassing, making a horse hate you. But when you do flexing, he should know, when you reach for that rope, he should know what's going to happen next. Horses like to do what they do the most. Horses like repetition. They like things that are easy. They like to know the rules. It needs to be clear. If a horse knows the rules, he likes complying because it's easy. And horses take the easy way out. They always want the easy way. Humans make it difficult, and then they blame the horse for being difficult, but they're making it difficult. So when a horse flexes, it should be easy for him. He should know what flex is, he should know how to flex, and he should know when you ask to flex that I have to turn my head and give you a flex. Is that you'll get these clinicians that have followed, I don't know, Clinton Pirelli, whoever teaches, I think they all teach flexing a little bit. Just making a horse soft, just making a horse. Basically, to me, what flexing does is it teaches a horse what you want and how you're talking to a horse. It teaches you to be soft and to communicate with the horse with a nice rein without pulling and hurting. And it teaches a horse to give to you, so I know I have the horse's mind. If you have the horse's mind, you'll control his feet. If you can't control his mind, you're not going to control his feet. So getting the horse's mind is kind of key here, and flexing is a good mind test to see if I have your mind. If I can reach down and do that and a horse flexes and goes, I got it, boss. You're the boss. You want me to flex? Let's go. What else do you want me to do? I know the horse is paying attention to me. I know we have a communication going. I know he's not having resistance. I don't have to pick it up and he goes, I don't want to flex today. Throws his hand, tries to pull the rein out of my hand. He tries to be a little, resistant. I don't have his mind. I can ignore that. I can manhandle. There's a bunch of different things I can do when he does that. But to me, it's like, I'm failing. Why is this horse not seeing me as a leader? Because I haven't moved him enough. I haven't got on him enough. I haven't ridden enough. If a horse starts resisting me on that, I'm probably going to back him up, because a horse doesn't like to back up. That's going to irritate him a little bit. A horse has to buckle up and do. If they don't like backing up, it's not real natural. So, to me, backing a horse up makes him really reads my resistance on whether or not he's paying attention, or he's going to continue to resist, or he's going to go, you know what, maybe I don't want to resist because I don't want to back up. Then I'll flex him again, and maybe he'll give me a nice flex. And that may be all it takes, is a couple backup steps, and he goes, I got it. You're going to put me through the hoops. You're going to make me change directions. You're going to lunge me. You're going to round pin me. You're going to do something that I really don't want to do. It's just easier if I flex when you ask me to. Perfect. Now we have communication. Let's go for our ride. So I was trying to explain to him what flexing was. So we go through all this that we've talked, and he goes, okay, so I need to work. And again, another thing with flexing is it's consistent for the horse. If every time I reach for the rein and I pick it up and the horse flexes, the horse learns, he will start reading. I don't even have to reach down to get Buddy to flex sometime. All I have to do is like lean forward like I'm going to reach for the rein. And he's like, he goes, I know what's happening. I feel your body. I'm paying attention. So it's a conditioned response that the horse reads your body. Now, if every time I reach for the rein, I yank that rein, I reach down there and I go, flex. Well, he ain't learning nothing. I can get him to flex, but he ain't learning. I have to get him to flex lightly and easily, and the more he anticipates it, the more I know I'm doing it right. Because I know, you know what? He knows what's going to happen before it happens. That's perfect. I want him to know what happens before it happens. I don't want to ambush my horse. I don't want him guessing. I don't want him thinking when this stupid human's on my back, I'm going to get ambushed and I don't know what the hell he wants, and I never know until he yanks on the bit and I feel pain, or he kicks me and I get stumped. I never know what the hell's going to happen when this human's on. I don't want a horse like that. I want him to go, you know what, I know what's going to happen before it happens, because this guy is smooth and easy and he does the same thing the same way, and I know what to expect and I can anticipate it, and it makes both our life easier. So, I mean, we went on and on. I mean, I could go on our conversation, but, you know, we talked for an hour and a half and now I'm recapping it. So, the thing that I said to him that kind of I thought was lost in the communication was, when I told him about flexing on the ground, in his mind, I think he thought, when a horse runs off, all I got to do is be able to go grab the rein and turn his head and make him flex, and I can shut him down, and he won't run off. Well, that's true to an extent, but that's not the way you get there. It has to be a process. I want to make it easy. I want the horse to already know when I reach down to grab that rein to one rein him, he already knows what's going to happen next, and he's going to have to flex, and he's not going to move, and he's going to stand still, and I'm going to stop his forward movement, and we're going to turn. We're going to do something different as soon as he feels me reach for it. I don't want to have to be in a crisis. We're running in a panic, and I'm hanging on the horn and going, oh, shit, I better reach down and grab that nose and yank it. That's not what you want to happen. Does that work? It'll work. If you yank it hard, you'll fall. Me and Mr. T took a big spill one time. He ran off on me. I lost my temper a little bit and went, God damn it, stop. And I reached down. I wasn't thinking. I yanked, and he had already got to full run because it takes him about that long. And we both hit the ground and slid, and I don't remember if I told that in one of my stories or not, but we both got up and went, what the hell happened? And I had to play it off like I meant for it to happen. I got up and went, yeah, see? I told you. And Miss T's like, damn, I don't want that to happen again. But that's not a good training. I was wrong. That was my fault. I did it wrong. Mr. T had to learn. Either of us could have got hurt. So it worked, but it wasn't ideal. Ideally, when I reached down there, I went, oh, I know what's going to happen. I better slow down. And now we have that relationship. I don't even have to reach down. I can just kind of pull up on the reins a little bit and maybe put a little tighter slack on one side. He's like, okay, I better slow down, or he's going to grab, you know, we'll go through this little testing phase. So, and again, the longer we're together, the less he tests, because he knows what's going to happen before it happens. But that doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't happen in a week. It doesn't happen in 30 days of training. It doesn't happen in 60 days of training. It never happens in training when someone else is doing it. The other thing I wanted to really touch on him, and I'm going to these different things, but when a horse is trained by manhandlers, it'll never work for someone that doesn't manhandle. So you people that think your horse is bad or mean, and you send it to a tough trainer, and that tough trainer gets your horse to do what you couldn't get it to do, it didn't fix the problem. The horse still doesn't respect you. He's still not going to do it for you for very long. If he does it for a while, maybe. But unless you handle him like the tough trainer that trained him, the horse is going to go back to doing whatever he wants to do. So that's the problem with sending people to trainer and you're not there watching. If you don't see how the trainer gets results and you don't do the same thing when you get the horse back, that training is nothing. That trainer basically trained the horse for them to ride. It would be like me giving Buddy or Mr. T to somebody that has no idea how to ride a horse and throw them out there. They are not going to ride Buddy and Mr. T. Yeah, I told you, I put my nephew on my one horse and he got cocky and I ran off with Mr. T and I knew Buddy would follow and he was hanging on. Oh, the rat! And I was like, hey, you know what? If you're going to get cocky, hang on. So, I mean, you cannot give a horse to somebody that doesn't understand how the horse has learned to communicate with the human. If you do, you set the horse up to fail and the human to fail. And if you're trying to tell a horse, you know, well, they told me that click means go. And you just think click means go, and you don't understand the process between how the horse learned that click means go. And what was done to the horse when it got clicked. And what was done if he didn't move when it got clicked. If you don't understand all that, pretty soon clicking may not, maybe run, may not. Because you just don't know. So, I wanted to cap on this video because it's a nice day and I was like, ah, shit, I was about to go get something to eat. And I was like, you know what, let me knock out a quick video on this call because I kind of wish I would have recorded it almost to hear people, because the questions he was asking was a lot of things that I get through emails and comments, etc. And it's just so damn hard to explain a complex subject. And I always equate it to, you know, would you call somebody and say, hey guy, you've been building homes for 40 years. I want to build my home. Can you send me an email on how to build it? The guy would look at you like you're a freaking idiot. Because there's just so much to building a home. Well, if you look at a horse as building a home, you have to get a good foundation. You have to make sure and design it. You have to have a plan for the end result on what it's going to look like when you're done. You can't just go out there and start hammering nails together and expect something to come out good. It's just not going to work. So hopefully you got something out of it. I mean, I ended up telling him, look, go to my webpage is too big to read everything. So I said, instead of going to my webpage and reading a whole damn webpage, go to my horsemanship page and at least read that. So you understand the fight flight of a horse. You understand the vision of a horse. You understand a horse a little bit better. And at least that'll give you a starting point. But
You know, and I told him, you know, the guy told him the horse was out of control. The guy told him the horse was freaking wild. The guy told him when you get on him, you better be a man and have a handful of reins. You know, he gave this horse this real bad resume in my book. You know, to a guy who's freaking wants a badass horse, it's kind of like, hey, man, that's a cool resume. But I'm telling you, Mr. T was a bad horse. Like I said, they were going to kill him, and he had several owners that all said he was too wild and crazy and he needed to be put down. And they were all using big bits and tie downs. And he rides in a rope halter perfectly fine now and will do anything. And he's a great horse. And calm seas don't make good sailors, and easy horses don't make good horsemen. This horse, I told him, is going to make you a better horseman, and you're going to appreciate it more because you had to work at it to get the results. And when this horse ends up dialing in and you get him to where you want to be, there's going to be a sense of accomplishment and closeness between you and a horse that you can't get from a video or from a clinic or from a book. So, all right, hopefully you got something out of that. Buddy, Mr. T, you're good boys. Go out there and flex them. If they don't flex, man, I'm going to flex them for 100 times. Buddy's like, oh, shit. All right, well, in that there.